Now, in the first program, we started bringing up some concepts through. Whatever you believe, if you are an atheist, if you are a Christian, if you are a Buddhist, if you are whatever your philosophy in life, your existential philosophy in life, needs to pass the test of human suffering. When you put human suffering into the equation, and whatever you believe needs to explain it, that truth that you believe needs to remain intact and unspotted without any bendings afterwards. So atheists are atheists 100% of the time because they've been exposed to human suffering, to human decadency, to mistreatment of animals, mistreatment of women, mistreatment of children. They've seen with their eyes and they said, I cannot believe in that God. But what about if that God is in fact not God at all? And that's what I'm trying to bring across in this presentation. We mentioned yesterday that we are, in one way or another, colorblind. We're running on four colors. And there are aspects of God in the scriptures that we are skipping through altogether. We can't see it. We can't differentiate. Now, the statement in the Bible, in the book of Luke, and at Luke chapter 10, 25 to 26, it says the following. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, this is Jesus, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He, Jesus, said unto him, what is written in the law? How readest thou? Or how do you read it? Do you know what is the most challenging part of the answer? Not the what is written in the law. But why does he say, how do you read it? Well, I read it within the English language. Or if I'm reading a Spanish Bible, within the Spanish language, right? Isn't that as simple as reading it? Or maybe not. Why is it that when the children of Israel came back from Babylon, from the exile, when they were reading the scriptures, they needed Ezra next to the one that was reading to do what? To give the meaning thereof. Well, I thought the meaning was nice and clean, nice and clear. Well, that is true, as long as you are not colorblind. Because if you are colorblind, if there are things that you are bringing, if you are things in your Christian experience, if there are things all around you that actually prevented you from seeing the full color, you might actually need someone that will tell you, you see that color is not actually brown, it's orange. Or you see that color is not actually blue, it's purple. Now, I'm going to bring you through the first book of the Bible. And the first book of the Bible is called Job. The first book of the Bible is called Job. Now, and if it's not a name, how do you say those words? J-O-B. Job. Okay? Friends, this is a clear evidence that the English language is a dyslexic language. Okay? Otherwise, how would you explain I read and I read? Another clear example that the English language is dyslexic. So bear with me and bear with my accent. We are going to go through the book of Job. You think, well, that's easy to say. Friends, it took me years to say Job rather than Job. You know, he was the less unemployed person in the Bible as far as I was concerned. Okay, now, the book of Job has 42 chapters, We are going to go and going to share with you a statement from the last chapter of the book of Job, chapter 42, verse 5. Chapter 42, verse 5. And it reads the following. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eye sees you. Now I want you to notice what is happening here. From chapter 39, God starts talking up to the first part of chapter 42, which is the last chapter. And Job has this amazing statement. You're looking at it and said, what is so amazing about it? He says, before I knew you by the hearing, but now I know you because I have seen you. Now, are you all familiar with the book of Job? The book of Job is the epicenter of Christian of human tragedy. Yesterday I shared how my wife is sleeping. This man lost in one day his 10 children. And following to that, his own health. Now, what does it mean when he says in the last chapter of the book, after going through the tragedy of his experience, what does it mean that before he knew God by the hearing? What does that mean, by the hearing? Where did he hear it from? Where did he hear about God? It's called the oral tradition. So the little boy, he's there around the fire, and grandpa and father and the neighbors and the elders, etc., they're telling stories. How many of you were brought up in a Christian home? And how many of you heard about God and heard of God and knew God by the hearing of how your parents share it with you? How your church share it with you, etc., etc., etc. Now, that's not a problem with that, except if the blueprint that they're sharing is faulty. If you have a faulty blueprint, you are going to share a faulty image. I'll give you an example. A few years ago, many years ago, I was probably 14 at the time. My neighbor, we lived in an apartment block, and it was typical Spanish culture back then. Now there has been a lot of immigration and things are changing. But back then, you knew everyone. You know, you knew that the neighbor in the third floor was getting divorced before everyone else. You know, that like everybody knew each other, everybody on each other's business, etc. So my neighbor, he was 3 years older than me. His name was Angel Manuel. He walked into the house, and I had the door open. Within two, three minutes, there was a little bit of noise inside the house. And he ran out of the house. And behind him was the father, Paco, with the big stick from the broom, running after him. Then my father was coming, and Angel Manuel passed him just like that. And then Paco passed him. My father entered into the house, he sat at the lunch table, and he looked at me and said, what was that all about? And I said, well, Angel Manuel showed up in the house with 1, 2, 3 earrings. So it lasted 2 minutes before the father was able to grab the broom. My father looked at me and said the following. If you show up in my house, not with 3, not with 2, with 1 tiny little in here, you won't end up with a hole. You will end up with the line that is going to be left behind as I pull it out of your ear. Now, this is now a challenging thought for you. My my son is like myself. We hate needles. So I am at no risk of my son coming home with a piercing. Okay? That's fantastic. You know, a fear of needles, you know, it will prevent your children from tattooing and from this. You know, I work on the fear of needles, you know, all my life with my children. They got a trauma, you know. Trying to get them now to get a vitamin B12 and an iron test, you know, they won't do it, you know, because they don't want to see a needle. But let's go to pretend that my son shows up in the house with a piercing here, or here, or anywhere else. The challenging thought is this, and this is something that the Lord actually challenged me with, Oscar. If your son would come in the house with a piercing here or here, would you in one way or another react in the same way as your father would have reacted upon you? And you know what was my honest answer to that question? Yes. And then the still small voice said to me, so in which way Christianity has changed you? Because your father is not a Christian. In which way has Christianity made a difference in you that your children can see it? Or, in other ways, which father are you reflecting? Which blueprint are you beholding that you therefore showing? So, Job has lost all his animals, all his children in one day, and his health. Then he goes through a time of venting. We'll say it that way. Because if we give some of the things that Job is saying to a psychologist or a psychiatrist, he will be on medication before chapter 14. Okay? He will be on medication before chapter 14. He says quite a number of heavy, heavy stuff. Woe to the day when it was announced, to my mother, you have a boy. Why my head was not crushed against the stone? That's a heavy stuff. That sounds very suicidal to me. Lord, give me an explanation. If I have sinned, he says, show me my sin. I have always walked in righteousness. I have not walked in iniquity, but you have made me a residue. Now I am the laughstock when I go out into the gate and the elders are there. Before I was an honorable man, and now even the Jews laughed at my face. That's heavy. And then, chapter 39, God starts talking to him. He shows himself to him, and then we get this statement. I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear. Knew you before for what I have heard and assimilated in my experience. But now I know you because I have seen you. Now don't wait for your children to become Christians just because they heard from you the gospel. They need to see full color God. There won't be anybody in heaven that have known God only by the hearing. No one. It has to be by the seeing. Even if he's through a mirror, actually face to face, but even if he's through a mirror, it will have to be an experience with God. Okay, so Job has three friends, and these friends are going to advise the very faithful believers, and they're going to give Job an advice. Basically, the advice is this. Okay, Job, you know, you're not pulling our legs here. You're onto something. You've got a secret sin somewhere there, and that's why this is happening to you, because these kind of things do not happen to good people. Right? So obviously, none of the apostles or martyrs got the memo. These things do not happen to good people. Now, where did they know about God? Where did these three friends with all this godly advice, where did they get the information from? How did they know God? What I'm going to show you now to you, you better check. I'm going to put it on the screen, but you better check it in your Bible, just making sure that I haven't put up an invisible verse there, you know, like Daniel chapter 13 or something like that. So check it. I'm going to put it on the screen, but you just check it, just making sure that it's in there, okay? So one of the friends, the most outspoken one, is Eliphaz, the Temanite. And he said the following from verse 12 of chapter 4 of the book of Job. He said the following. Now, he's ready to build up his case, and he needs some credibility of what he's going to say. And what better credibility that, hey, this comes from God, and this is what God is telling me to tell you. And he says, now a thing was secretly brought to me, and mine, what? Ear received a little thereof, in thought from the visions of the night, when deep sleep followed on men. So he's having this vision in the evening, secretly coming to his ear when everybody else is sleeping in the darkest hour of the night. In the dark hour. Fear came upon me and trembling, which made all my bones to shake. So whatever it was brought upon him, what? Fear and trembling. First Timothy tells us that God did not give us the spirit of what? Of fear, but of what? Of power and of love and of a sound mind. Because I'll tell you what, if you don't have a sound mind, you don't have love. And if you don't have love, you don't have power. And if you don't have sound mind, love, or power, you're a very fearful individual. Fear came upon him and trembling, which made all my bones to shake. Now, then, wait for it. A spirit passed before my face, the hair of my flesh stood up. Now, I want you to notice something here. This guy is in the middle of the night, when everybody else is sleeping, in the dark hour of the night, all of a sudden something comes to his ear, he is trembling and shaking, and a spirit comes, and he passes before my face, and the hair of my flesh stood up still. He's not done yet. It stood still, but I could not discern the form thereof. An image was before mine eyes. There was silence, and I heard a voice saying, so this is spirit with an image form which he could not fully discern, maybe like a, you know, like a reflection, kind of like a hologram. Is that the word, hologram or hologram? Okay. This is what it says. This is what the Spirit says. Shall mortal man be more just than God? Shall a man be more pure than his maker? Of course not. Right? A mortal man is no more righteous than God, right? And he's definitely no more pure than his maker, right? Right. I mean, God does say, you know, you'll be holy as I am holy, but let's go on to take the first verse as going to give a bit of margin on that verse. Notice the next one. Behold, he put not trust in his servants, and his angels he charged with folly or foolishness. Hold on a second. Doesn't God trust his servants? He doesn't put any trust in his servants? Yes or not? Does God trust his servants? Huh, it's called walking by faith. You know who is walking by faith, really? God. Because he's looking at us and thinking, they're going to be my righteousness. Well, that's walking by faith. He walks by faith. That's why when he says, walk as I walk, guess what it is? Walk by faith. I'm having a lot of faith in you. You only need to believe in the Almighty God. He needs to believe in us. So, notice what he says. He puts no trust in his servants. Now, let me ask you a question. Does the Lord consider his angels foolish? How much less in them that they dwell in house of clay whose foundation is in the dust, which are crushed before the moth? How many of you can see here a mix of truth and error? Can you see the mix of truth and error? Yeah. Now, Eliphaz is hearing, and now he's going to give the godly lecture to Job. Question, who was that spirit? Satan. Because Job knew God only by the hearing of his community, his environment, the experience of his father, the grandfather, etc. And now his church friends, they're getting revelations from whom? From Satan. Now, guys, let's go to be honest. Do you expect Satan to give you the proper revelation of the character of God? Now, I'm going to share with you this quote from a biblical commentary. It's a biblical commentary from the book The Ministry of Healing. Pages 112 and 113. It says the following: God is working day by day, hour by hour, moment by moment, to keep us alive, to build up and restore us. Sickness, suffering, and death are work of an antagonistic power. Satan is the destroyer. God is the restorer. Oh. Now, that quote is true 70% of the time. 100%? Really? 100%? How many think that this quote is true 90% of the time? Okay, 98% of the time. How many times you reckon that Satan is the destroyer and God is the restorer? True 99.9% of the time. How many of you think that that quote, that statement, based on what you know of the scriptures, is true 100% of the time? Okay. I saw your hands. Just saying. Okay. If you come to the same book, to chapter 1, we notice that as he is actually being inflicted with so much destruction of animals, cattle, camels, all his property, and then his children, one servant comes and tells him, all this has been destroyed, it was only me left to tell you. And then another one comes. So if you read this from verse 16, so chapter 1, verse 16, one of the servants come and says, while he was yet speaking, the previous servant telling him the bad news, there came also another servant, and said, the fire of God is fallen from heaven, and hath burnt up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I only am escaped along to tell you, or to tell thee. How many of you picked up what this guy just said? Fire came down from God out of heaven and destroyed. Question. Now that know the story, because you know the story of Job. Who brought the fire? And the destruction? And from where? From heaven. Like from heaven, from the word heaven is the sky, by the way. Okay? Not heaven like, but from the heaven, from the sky. But what is this servant saying? Where did he get that information from? also by the hearing. See, they all have the same doctrine, friends. Have you realized? Up to chapter 42, they all have the same doctrine. Now, question. If Job is saying in chapter 42, the last book of the entire of his book, right at the end says before. So what is before? Before is chapter 41 backwards, right? Before I knew you by the hearing. When God said, or when Job says, God has given, finish that one. God has taken away. Can we say for certain that Job knew what he was talking about in chapter 1? Can he say for certain that he knew what he was talking about in chapter 1? He cannot say for certain because in chapter 42 he's telling us that he had no idea what he was talking about. Did you get that? Who took away? Satan. Satan took away. Would it be that an atheist is blaming God, giving the word God to Satan? But you know what is worse? Would it be that some Christians are attributing to God attributes that are Satan's? And if that is the case, what kind of God are they representing? Good and evil. Okay. It gets worse, guys. All right. You are in a theater. Behind me is going to be a representation of the book of Job. So the curtains open. The first thing that you see is different thrones in heaven. God is there, and the sons of God, the representatives of God in all the unfallen worlds, are there for a meeting. So all the sons of God are there, representatives of God from unfallen worlds. And from the earth, who meant to be the Son of God that meant to come from the earth to represent the children here on earth? Who? At that time? Adam. See, in the book of Luke, chapter 3, it tells us the genealogy, and it says, Adam, the son of God, that meant to live forever. So he became the representative for us here. He meant to be the one showing up, as from all the other places the sons of God were showing up as a meeting, from the earth came, however, Satan instead of Adam, because of the sin, because Adam gave the kinship to Satan. Correct? Okay. So over there, God says this to Satan. Where are you coming from? And he is a boaster, and he goes, I'm coming from the earth, running to and fro in my territory. And then God opens his mouth and you wish, shh, don't say anything, come on. God goes and asks the question, have you seen my servant Job? And you know what is coming, and you go, oh, wow, what a weak favor you did to the man. Why did you bring it to the devil's attention? Question, did God bring it to the devil's attention? No. Job was already in Satan's heart. He's been after that case for a long time. God brings up the sin in your heart. So he goes and says, I'm going to give you the opportunity to expose up your sin. Have you considered Job? Did you notice that Satan doesn't go and say, Job, tell me a little bit, what address, postcode? Do you notice how quickly he, of course I know him. Of course he knew him. God didn't bring to the attention of Satan Job. Satan had Job here because he wanted to get rid of him. By the way, does Satan wanted to kill Job, yes or not? Careful. Satan wanted for him to curse God and die. A martyr that is praising God in the fire is of no good for Satan. It's actually seed for the gospel. Satan does not want you dead, friends. He wants you to curse God and then die. He doesn't want you to die as my wife was fell asleep. He doesn't want that. Because we got hundreds and thousands of testimonies coming now because of her testimony of faith, and people coming to the faith because of it. He wants you to curse God and die. Okay, so now you see that scene. And he said, well, you got a protection. And he says, okay, do as you please. In other words, do as your heart, sinful desires want to do. Who has freedom of choice here? Only humans? Only humans have freedom of choice? Does the devil have freedom of choice? Was he exercising his freedom of choice? Was God bound by his love, which is embedded into it, the freedom of choice? Yes or not? Yes. Okay, I'm going to ask you a question. Is God limited? Absolutely, he is. Can God do evil? No, he's limited. God is limited by his character. And in his character has a principle called love, to an extent that humans are actually colorblinded to. We colorblinded to the extent of God's love, in which is embedded into it the freedom of choice. That does just not include us, friends. That's why there was a rebellion in heaven, because it included absolutely every creature of his creation. What is the desire of Satan? He wants to crush Job. He wants to make his life miserable. And he wants it because he's thinking he's going to curse you. And he's talking to God, and he's challenging God in front of all the other sons of God that have not rebelled yet. Let me touch him. Do you know what he's saying? Are you not love? Are you going to restrict me? Did you catch it? He is actually preaching to the converted. To the other sons of God, he wants to drop and throw their seeds of doubt. Are you going to stop me? Come on, God, say it. Say that I've got no authority to charge him. Say that you are going to prevent him from tribulation. Say it, that you are going to put such a Trump wall around him that I won't be able to touch him. Say it so they can hear it and they can see that you are a fake, that your love is not taken to the ultimate consequences. And that you will need to resource to force against me to prevent my freedom of choice. Say it. And God goes and said, do as you please, because I'm not going to say it. So the curtains closes. Next scene opens up again. And now the scenario is not in heaven. It's down on earth. And you see these things happening upon Job. And these things happening upon Job. And these things happening upon Job. And then closes again. Then the same scenario in heaven happens again. And now he says, oh man, this guy is not cursing. He's just wrestling with the whole thing. He walks into the council of heaven, and God just says, have you seen Job? Of course he's seen it. He's in here. He's giving him indigestion. Of course. He wants to get rid of him. He wants to touch him. He wants to torture him. But he doesn't want to kill him until he curses God. And then he closes again. Opens up again the curtains, and now he's at the ear of his wife, of Job's wife. How do we know that was Satan speaking through the wife? Because the same very words are replicated by now a human being. Curse God, she said, and die. And then he closes. And then opens up again. And you see Job there with boils, with infection, with maggots growing, with shaved up sackcloth and ashes, in pain, in agony. And he starts venting out, very badly, venting out. Now, friends, you know something as the audience that Job doesn't know. What do you know that he doesn't know? What do you know? That he's not God. He's actually Satan. And especially when you hear him saying, you know, God, why are you doing this to me? You know, I was you go, you as an audience, it's like, you don't want to spoil it. You know, you don't want to spoil the theater production. But it's just like you're so tempted to say, man, stop it. It wasn't him. You're barking at the wrong tree. He was the devil. Who are you holding on? And then chapter 39 comes. And the audience goes, finally. Chapter 39, here comes God. God comes into the picture. And God starts talking to Job. And you are waiting. Because you are humans. And as a human being, if you were given the opportunity to be God and fill up the gaps of 2.5 chapters at the end of the book, what are you really, really dying to say to Job? What are you really, really, really dying? What do you want him to know? What do you want to tell him? Huh? My son, it wasn't me. So chapter 39 comes, chapter 40 comes, chapter 41 comes, and they're long chapters. And the beginning of chapter 42. In which chapter does God say to Job, hey, my son, all this, it wasn't me. At what chapter? 39, 40, 41? Anyone? He doesn't say it. He doesn't say it. You gotta be kidding me. We're dying to tell the guy, poor thing. He wasn't God. And God doesn't say it. What I'm going to say to you now is going to add a whole shade of new color in your brain about the character of God. Do you know why God doesn't say anything? The moment God says it wasn't me, what he automatically by default, what is he actually saying? It was someone else. It wasn't me automatically. He's saying he was someone else. And in the book of Revelation tells us who is the accuser of the brethren, and that one is not God. God is not the accuser of the brethren because God is limited to his character, and he will die on his character and for his character as he was manifested on the cross of Christ. Like, he believes so much in his principle that if you come to him, it's because you love him, and you have come to love him because you have known him, that he's ready to die for that principle. And not just that, and to cope it. Cope what? Their whole world, friends, their whole insurance companies are blaming God. What happens with insurance companies when there is a huge tornado and you're trying to claim it? What do they call it? An act of God. And what is God doing? He's coping it, friends. He's actually coping it. And that was actually manifested in a big, big time by Jesus Christ in front of Pilate. Because that guy is saying lies about Jesus, and Jesus doesn't go, hold on, just one second, about regarding that guy over there. false testimony. I mean, he was lying like, woo, like a fisherman. He was lying a lot. Did Jesus ever say that? Why not? Because you've seen me, he says. You've seen the Father. You've seen me. You've seen the Father. God is limited, friends, by his character. God will not do evil, though he has the muscle to do it, because he's limited by his character, and he will stop being God if he does it. Are you following? Okay. Friends, this is something that we are going to build upon. God is working day by day, hour by hour, moment by moment, to keep us alive, to build up and restore us. Sickness, suffering, and death are work of an antagonistic power. Satan is the destroyer. God is the restorer. Do you know what that does to your mind? Do you know what that does to my mind when I've seen my wife sick? I'm saying, oh Lord, you're just opening my eyes to evil. He doesn't deserve my worship. The evil one I'm talking about. God, you open my eyes, what evil can do. He is a hard taskmaster. He doesn't deserve my worship. Do you know what that does to the mind of a young 17 years old person that still lives within me? When I'm walking up, running up the hill to my mom's house because my father is leaving my mom, and I'm praying all the way to this hearing of God image that I had. God, don't allow this. God, don't allow this. Don't allow this. And my mom is left there unconscious on the floor for a panic attack, and my father is walking away, and for years I blame God. Friend, if you are an atheist, and if you see all this evil in the world, if we don't blame it on God, we need to blame it on someone else, right? Somebody's causing the evil, correct? That is Satan himself. But it gets better for us and worse for him. Because the primary work of the little God, which is the title of this sermon, the little God, with not a capital, but lowercase God, is to remain hidden. Have you noticed that an atheist only debates about God? Never debates about the other. So, I thought the following. What is the first book in the Bible? The book of Job. Somebody said Genesis again. The book of Job is the first book written. First book written in the Bible. First chapter, first verses, the great controversy is introduced. Right from the start. The great controversy is introduced. Right from the star. And now, I'm thinking this. What about if we are no longer the audience in the theater of the play of the book of Job, but in fact, we are the play? What about if whatever you're going through is the play that is making you and I a spectacle to the world? And what about if the angels and the sons of God all throughout the universe, those and fallen worlds, are sitting there where you are, and you all are here playing out your lives of suffering, and they got like, look at him.
He has forgotten to give thanks. He's questioning you, Father. Can I say something? And God says, no, Gabriel, just stay there. Don't say anything. Friends, your life is a spectacle for the entire universe. Whatever you say is being viewed by the entire universe. They know something that we now only know by faith through the book of Job. That whatever you've gone through, friends, it wasn't God. To the atheists listening, it wasn't God. He was the antagonistic power. Why did God allow it? Because God is ruled by his own character. And the center, pivotal anchor of his character is love. And in love, freedom of choice is non-negotiable. And the devil has a freedom of choice against us. Guess what? You too have a freedom of choice to praise God while he, the devil, touches you. What comes out of your mouth, what comes out of your risen hands, lift up to heaven, is also your freedom of choice. I'm closing with this. I came across a story of a man that was about to be burned. He had all the branches around him. And the Inquisition of the time, probably Spanish Inquisition, you don't trust the Spaniards. I'm the only one that can say that. They brought the family, they brought their wife and the children before him and said to him, if you deny Christ, we'll untie you and you can actually give a hug to your wife and to your children. But that man knew that it wasn't God doing this. Neither the one doing the bargaining. So they ask him again, if you deny Christ, you can come down and hang your wife and your children. Do you know what he said? I love it. Sometimes short words accomplish much. He looked at them, smiled with peace in his eyes, and he said, lead it up. Lit it up. He was there, ready to be burned. He understood that we ought not to fear the one that can touch our bodies. Do you understand that? We ought not to fear the one that can touch our bodies. We've got God. So I'm hoping that with this second presentation, friends, it gets worse for the devil as the presentations continue, and it gets worse, and it gets best for God. But beyond that, I'm hoping that by the time we finished, the brown starts looking more like an orange, and the second blue that you couldn't distinguish from the other blue starts looking more like a purple, and all of a sudden, the true rainbow of God is exposed before your eyes. If happens here, as it has happened in Spain when we presented the atheist God and the principles, biblical principles that will be extracted from the scriptures. If it happens the same here and to those that will be listening to these messages in English, by the end, by the seventh message, you will have an image of God that many of you have never seen before. You haven't got rid of the four colors. You just added three on top of it. And that is my desire. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you because you are our God and you are loving and you are strong and your judgments are always in favor of your people. We thank you, Lord, because you know best for us. And we thank you, Father, for the light revealed through the book of Job about you. Because it's not a book about the devil. It's a book about you. Thank you, Father. Bless us, Lord. And as the colors are starting to become more distinct in our minds, let the Holy Spirit, Lord, illuminate them even further. In Jesus' holy and precious name, amen.